about you guys. That song always makes me feel good. Good morning. Good morning. Happy Thanksgiving week to everyone. I know this is going to be a week filled with a lot of food, a lot of time with family, but also a really great opportunity to get those open houses in and to get those showings in while people have time off. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We've got a lot to kind of go through and cover today. As always, got to start with our TCPA. Just a reminder to please make sure you are following our TCPA. Okay, I did want to know a little bit on just Mortgage Minute. I wanted to give you an idea of where the rates are. Now I'm going to note a couple things here. So the rate had not been updated for this morning. So this is as of November 18th. I am going to note one of the things that I want to share with rates is when you are looking at these, it's going to be really good for you to establish a baseline, right? A baseline. So what does that mean? It means that when we look at loan amount, when we look at the down payment amount, right? When we look at the credit scores, all of those different things are going to impact the mortgage rate that we get, right? So there's a lot of different calculators like this one. This is the Google calculator that I wanted to show, giving you a baseline of a 500K mortgage, down payment of 5%, credit score between 720 and 739. This is a great calculator to kind of play with to see a little bit of the different loan types. You are also able to go in and add different loan types to compare so that you can see some of the different options that exist. So just wanted to kind of share this with you today. There's a lot of different calculators that we've gone over that I've showed you guys. Some of those on NAR's website where you can actually play a little bit more with the affordability index and find out how much inventory exists for a particular client. So this is just another calculator that I wanted to share with you guys as well. With that being said, so you notice those rates are a little bit under 7%, right? We did experience a little bit of a dip last week in the rates because inflation, right? Inflation came a little bit under what was being anticipated. So just to note, we are still below, right? We are still below the historical average on rates from the 1980s, which is when we had inflation similar to the inflation numbers that we are experiencing right now. So just to put it in perspective, right? Because we know that the inflation impacts our rates, we are still below that kind of average that we were in this time period over here. You see how high the rates were over here in the 80s, which is when we had similar inflation numbers to what we have right now. In fact, the rate is hovering a little bit below the national average since 1971. So we are above the average from 1990, but we are below the average from 1971, just to put it in perspective over time. All right. And then the last note on that, again, you know, rate buy downs, still a thing. We are seeing kind of mortgage applications that slow down a little bit. But again, those clients that are ready, willing, and able to proceed right now have a high sense of urgency, right? Those are the ones that are serious and ready to move forward. Okay. So we're going to jump right into the numbers. And then I have a couple announcements at the end that I want to make sure to share with you. Today, we're going to be looking from October 1st through the 20th to November 1st through the 20th. So where we are month to date, as well as year over year in comparison to November 1st through the 20th of last year. So right here in the fourth quarter of the year, a reminder that we always experience seasonality in the fourth quarter of the year. But there's going to be a couple trends that are very interesting that we are seeing on the market right now. The first of those that I want to point out, so we look at the number of properties for sale, right? When we see a dip in the number of properties sold and we continue to see listings coming on the market, we tend to see the number of properties that are on the market for sale go up, right? So generally, we experience this number being a little bit we tend to see this go up if there's a lot of inventory coming on the market. What we are actually seeing right now is that this is pretty balanced, right? So 0.6% change. It is up 73.3% from the same time a year ago. So last November, there was 73.3 more properties for sale on the market than there is right now. So we're seeing that inventory number kind of drop here. Number of properties sold month over month down 22.4% month to date and down 56.3% from the same period of time last year. So let's look at where we are with the listings. So new listings also decreasing, right? We're down. Now, again, that is to be anticipated when we move into fourth quarter of the year, which is what we're in right now. So down 25% month to date, down 33.7% from the same time a year ago. What's interesting here is this is down 33%. The pendants are down about 56%, which is why we're seeing this increase of inventory, number of properties for sale from this same time a year ago, right? Is that the number of properties that have sold are down. And we're also seeing that kind of decline, right, in terms of new listings that are coming on the market. And so we are seeing the number of properties sold is up from the same time a year ago, right? It is pretty balanced considering where we are month to date right now. So the month over month change is not as significant here with the numbers that we have of new listings going down about 25% and pendants down about 24.7. When we look at our average active price, this is part of the reason that month to date, we have an average active price that is in the green, right? So these things always play into each other. This is what I want you to think about when we start considering this idea of supply and demand, right? There is a limited amount of supply. So we saw that the number of properties actually sitting for sale is fairly balanced because we saw a decrease in number of properties sold, but we also saw a decrease in new listings coming on the market. And so this average active price, where in reality, when we look at the properties, the average active and the average sold price, we've been seeing that across the board. So if we look at California as a whole, right, we've seen a trend where prices have gone down, right? This has been probably the fourth consecutive month that across California as a whole, we've seen this sort of kind of price reductions that are occurring. And yet when we look at where we are month to date on these trends, right? So from the 1st through the 20th, we're seeing an average active price that is in the green here and an average sold price that is up 12.6% from this same time period a month ago. Now, obviously this week is going to skew our numbers a little bit, as does the last week of October, because we have Halloween in October, right at the very end of the month. And then we have Thanksgiving here in the month of November. So we'll see where these numbers kind of end up at the end of the month. But it is important to kind of note that we are seeing a little bit of this average sold price pickup. Now, if you are listing property in these areas, right? If you are listing property in these areas, this doesn't mean going overprice the property, right? Because just because we see an average active or an average sold price that is in the green, it still means we need to price competitively, but there is a little bit less inventory on the market. And that's kind of driving some of this price point right here. Again, the clients that are looking right now are also more serious about moving forward, but there's of course a lot of negotiation that's occurring. Let's look at this average sold price up 14.4% from this same time a year ago. So our average sold price is still in the green here as well. That's going to be important for us to keep an eye on and continue to kind of watch, because we know that as we've priced out in LA County last month, when we were looking at these numbers, the average sold price month over month had declined. So we want to see where it ends up month to date. But as of right now, this is putting us a little bit more balanced, a little bit more around what we saw in September. So a little bit before October. All right. Looking at our month's inventory, this has gone up. So we saw an increase that happened right over here in the month of October. We're up about 31.5% from this same time a month ago. I would anticipate that we end a little bit higher. We are starting to move into higher inventory territory. 3.8, if we start moving into 4 and 5 range, that is where we start seeing a little bit of a change in what we consider a technical seller or buyer's market, right? So this, we're going to continue to kind of watch this because that is a pretty big jump. And then our days on market up 6.1%. So from 33 to 35 days on market month to date. And then sold versus original list price hitting at about 96% of original list. So remember when I said we want to watch where we were, or where we are in the pricing, right? That average active price is a little bit higher, and yet sold versus original list price is a little bit lower. So we're still seeing that negotiation that happens right around here as well. Last month, we were hitting about 97% of list. Now we're at about 96% of list price. Okay, looking at Orange County. So with Orange County, we move into our higher price point area. When we look at the number of properties for sale, month to date, down 1.4%. That's fairly balanced here. Up 157.9% from the same time a year ago, right? So there's significantly more properties on sale than there were at this same time a year ago. We look at this time frame. I want you to kind of take a look at this, right? We look at our October and our September numbers, and then we saw the biggest decline in the number of properties for sale happen around December before we started seeing those inventory numbers go up. We're seeing a little bit of a difference right here. Our highest inventory month thus far in Orange County has actually been July, right? So we haven't returned to July numbers just yet, but it is outside of normal trend. This is fairly balanced. It actually went up last month. We're seeing that go down slightly this month as well. Number of properties sold, right? Number of properties sold down 35.1%. So that's down 59.4% from this same time a year ago. But again, remember that the last 2 years, right, 2020 and 2021, we experienced a very skewed seasonality because of how much money had kind of been infused into the economy, right? There was a lot of real estate deals that happened over the course of the last 2 years that skewed our normal seasonality. So we're getting a little bit of a combination of a couple factors when we see some of these numbers here. That's going to be a combination of returning to a more normal seasonality, right? But also the fact that we've experienced such high rates of inflation. And so our mortgage rates are significantly higher right now. We look at our inventory trends. We are experiencing a drop in listings. So we were down 25% in Los Angeles County, down 29.4% for Orange County. We're seeing those listing numbers go down. At properties pended, down 21.3% month to date. We look at this year over year, number of new listings down 41.8%, number of properties pended down 53.6%. So seeing kind of that decline that's happening a little sooner, right? But still it's fairly on trend in terms of just overall, fairly on trend in terms of the decline, right? But it is a little bit more, it kind of started a little sooner. It's a little more severe than what we saw right over here. Okay, looking at our pricing trends. So in LA County, we're seeing that the average active price month to date and the average sold price month to date was in the green, right? Meaning that it's increased. Average active price in Orange County, this is fairly balanced on baseline, but we are seeing a decline in that average sold price. Now, what's really important to look at over here is this average sold price year over year, right? Average sold price year over year, we are actually starting to experiencing a decline here. So largest, highest price point county, and we're starting to see that decline. We tend to see something that happens when we start seeing declines in real estate. We tend to see the areas that appreciated the fastest kind of experience those drops the fastest, the areas that appreciated the highest, right? Highest price point areas tend to experience a little bit more steep or significant drop off. So we're starting to see that here. If you are right? If you are selling in Orange County, you're pricing property in Orange County, I encourage you to go back a little bit more. So we don't want to look at just months of date. We know right now, right, a property that is selling for less this November than it would have last November. But I guarantee that in this area, it is still selling higher than it was 2 years ago, likely still selling higher than it was a year and a half ago, right? So even though it's starting to sell and we're starting to see that decline here in the average sold price of 2.5%, that's a little balanced. Still, that's not a huge decline just yet. But if I'm pricing property in Orange County, right, and we're talking about urgency of the client to not wait any longer so they don't keep losing equity, is now we're in a position where they're starting to lose some of the gains that they made over the last year, right, with this decline in our average sold price here. So we want to look back a little further to kind of figure out where is it that their price was still higher. It's highly likely that if we went back about 18 months, we'd still see that average sold price is higher than it was 18 months ago in this particular county. All right, and then looking at our absorption rates, so moving up into 3.2 months of inventory thus far, month to date, we'll see again where we end up. Not as high as LA County, where we're about 3.8 months of inventory year to date, almost in that 4 territory. We're still at under 3.5 months of inventory here as well. And then our days on market. What's interesting here is the days on market actually saw a little bit of a decrease. So down about 2 days, about 5.9%. And then that sold versus original list price, we're at about 94% of original list. The biggest difference being that unlike in LA County, where we saw that average active price and that average sold price in the green, right? The average active and average sold price in Orange County is in the red. So this decline might be a little bit more steep here than just 1.1% because that original list price is a little lower. Okay, Riverside County. Again, number of properties for sale going up about 3.2%. So not a very steep increase, but it is a pretty significant increase in terms of the number of properties for sale month to date. Month over month from a year ago, up 129.9%. We look at number of properties sold. We're seeing that decline of 32.7% month to date, down 61.6% year over year. Let's look at our inventory trends. So number of new listings experiencing a decline here. What's interesting right over here is that we saw this decline be pretty steep. Right? We saw the biggest jump from November to December, because again, we get into those holiday seasons, right? And in holiday season, some people don't want to have their house on the market. Those that do are in a hurry to sell, right? But there are some that won't want to have their house on the market. They don't want to do showings. They don't want to do all of these different things during holiday season. So we tend to see that most significant jump right over here. This is a little bit more even. We even saw a pretty significant jump from October to November last year. This has been a little bit of a smoother, still decline, right? But a little bit of a smoother decline here. So number of new listings down 24.2% month to date, down 36% from this same month a year ago. A number of properties pended actually up. So in Riverside County, the number of properties pended month to date is in the green here. Right? It's in the green. This is up 0.9%. That's fairly balanced, but it's not down, which is what we are seeing is a trend in most of the other markets. And then pended from last year, down 47.4%. We look at our pricing trends. So another area where that average active price is in the green. So we're seeing that pricing here actually go up a little bit in terms of the average active price. We saw that last month as well. However, from this same time a year ago, down 5%. And then that average sold price is down both month to date, down 4.3%, and then down year over year, 2%. So again, if we go back about 18 months, this average sold price is likely going to be in the green here, where it's still a little bit higher. But if you were talking to homeowners in Riverside County that are considering selling their home, urgency is of the essence here, right? Before they lose any more of that equity. And then our absorption rates over here. So this is going to be really interesting for Riverside County, depending on if we end the month at this number. Jumping up to 5.2 months of inventory. This will be the first time on any of the counties, if we end the month like this. So I say if, because again, right, the next week and a half is going to kind of dictate that on what this really looks like when we end the month. However, if we do end the month here at about 5.2 months of inventory, that puts us in a technical balance market. So historically, a seller's market was determined as 1 to 5 months of inventory. 5 to 7 months of inventory is considered a balanced market. And 7+ months of inventory is what is considered technically a buyer's market, right? Doesn't mean one market is better than the other to purchase in. It's just kind of the technical definition with inventory. With that being said, however, when we go into a balanced markets tend to be the shortest market that we have. So what does that mean? It means as soon as we hit balanced market territory, inventory moves up pretty quickly and we stay in a balanced market for a very short period of time. So it's not like right now we've stayed in a seller's market for years, right? We've been in this kind of less than 5 months of inventory for many, many years now, over 5 years that we've been in kind of this type of market. When we go into balanced market territory, 5 to 7 months of inventory, historically that doesn't last very long. So it's not like we're in balanced market territory for a year or 2 years, it's months, right? If that. And then we move into other markets. So then we move into buyer market territory, inventory kind of shoots up very quickly. So considering this is the first county that we're seeing that inventory number rise up to this 5.2. So again, we'll see where it ends up at the end of the month. But if we do rise into that 5.2, I'm not surprised that it's Riverside County, considering that they're one of the higher risk counties that we've been talking about for months already, that they're considered highest risk in the nation, right? Because of a couple of factors. They had the highest rate of forbearance during the mortgage forbearance of the past 2 years. They also have a lot of new homeowners. So there's a lot of people that relocated to Riverside County during the pandemic because their jobs became 100% remote or 100% virtual, that haven't necessarily had time to build up equity, right? So they haven't been there long enough to build up a significant amount of equity. Plus you had so many defaults that were already in occurrence there. And so all of those things are going to kind of combine to create a little bit of a very kind of high risk market here. Because what we could have happen is that all of a sudden, a lot of inventory floods the market. And if we start seeing on the flip side of that, a lot of job loss, things like that, then that could impact more kind of foreclosure properties coming on the market. Supply and demand, if there is too much supply and not enough demand, then that starts to impact prices, which then impacts the value of the other properties in that area. And considering that people haven't had a chance to kind of build up that equity, that could create a little bit of a short sale environment, not immediately, right? Not immediately, but we could see that happen for Riverside County. So we just look at all these different factors and kind of see how it plays out. Now, does that mean that it was a bad buy? No, for somebody that can afford, you know, their payment, that they're comfortable, that they, you know, got a beautiful home out there. As long as they're able to meet the payments, it doesn't matter so long as they keep the home long enough, right? Because that's where we really see this kind of regain. Markets go up and markets go down. Doesn't make something a bad buy just because the immediate value right now may go down a little bit, right? If they're going to keep the home long enough, they will recoup that equity over time. That's what we see historically, is that prices go up and down, but they always go up and down on an upward trajectory over time, right? But we are going to just want to monitor this county. I'll be very curious to see where we end up at the end of the month here. If we stay with such a significant increase in inventory moving into that 5% as well. So this is going to be a county to watch right now. And then last but not least here, our average days on market up about 39%. And then that sold versus original list price, still fairly balanced here at about 96% of list. So we'll keep an eye on that inventory number. All right, San Bernardino County. Number of properties for sale down 3.8%. So we saw a little bit of a decrease, right, last month. This is not in the green. So we saw this be in the green in some counties, in the red in some. We're kind of fluctuating right there. Number of properties sold month to date down 34%. Number of properties for sale from this same time a year ago up 96.8%. So trending high, like we're seeing across the various counties. And the number of properties sold down 63.2%. We look at our new listings, number of new listings down 32.1% month to date, right? To be anticipated. But again, we saw a real significant kind of drop off over here. So this was pretty, a little bit more, it kind of occurred faster last year, right? We're seeing this a little bit smoother, still going down, just a little bit smoother. And new listings, so down 32.1%, down 42% from a year ago. Pen nids down 20.6% month to date, down 53.3% from a year ago. We look at our average active price. We're in the red here, right? Average active price down 0.8%. But the average sold price month over month is balanced. And that average sold price year over year is in the green. We saw this be in the red for a couple of our counties. Now we can see we're still in the green here. So this is a county where the property is still worth more than it was a year ago, where we're not having to go back 18 months, right? Something to talk about with your sellers out here. Okay, and then absorption rate also jumping up to about 5.2 here, right? So we were at about 3.5. San Bernardino County being a little bit similar to Riverside County. Riverside County has been considered the highest risk in the nation, right? But when we went over forbearance numbers, I would say maybe about, at this point, it's probably been about 6 to 7 months ago when we were talking about this. We noted that San Bernardino County is also a higher risk market, not as high as Riverside County, but still a higher risk market here. And so hitting it about 5.2 months of inventory, we're going to continue to monitor these two counties. This is these are two that have a pretty significant jump that are going to be indicators of a little bit more movement that we see in terms of this just inventory numbers overall, as well as some of the impact that this could have then on price if we see a big uptick in the amount of inventory that's available, especially with that kind of decline in demand. Now, what's going to be really interesting on this though, is that if our inflation numbers, right, if inflation numbers stay low or continue trending downward, we could see some changes in interest rates. The other thing I want to know is that California specifically, right, so California legislature, they're going to be reconvening in a few weeks. We just came out of an election term, right? So we just had everybody went to go vote on different things. And there was a lot of things that happened this past voting cycle, because there was a lot of changes in districting lines. So there was a lot of areas that got redistricted, which means that we have a lot of kind of different candidates that are now coming into the legislature. When they reconvene in a few weeks, they're going to be looking at some of the challenges that we're having specific to California when it comes to housing. Two of the factors that are a really big part of that is that we have a couple things that are going on. California is underbuilt, right? California is underbuilt. There is a shortage of affordable housing. So this is part of why housing element comes into play. There's a shortage of affordable housing. And affordability is difficult right now. So some rents are too high. And then on the home prices, because of the rates being as high as they are right now, that's causing an affordability issue. So we are going into a really unique year with this new legislator kind of coming out. Is they may, you know, look at the housing market and say, okay, how can we create more affordability? How can we create more opportunities? So right now, looking at a couple of these markets that are having kind of this big increase in supply, this becomes dangerous territory if we see a very big decline in demand. But demand could also be impacted by whatever the legislative moves are made by California legislator to impact affordability. So there could be new programs that come in, right? We're starting to see more grant programs that are available right now, more down payment assistance programs. So that's going to kind of impact what we see with this market. But again, just something that we want to kind of keep an eye on here. Okay, and then average days on market, month to date up 16.7%. This is the single biggest days on market increase across all four counties. So from 36 days on market to 42 days on market. Saw a big jump in the inventory numbers and now a big jump in the average days on market. It's the only one where we're in the double digit percentile on average days on market. This is going to be something for us to watch. And then sold versus original list price, very similar to what we're seeing, about a 1% decline month to date here. Okay. I want to note, before you go and start cooking your turkeys and getting your mashed potatoes and stuffing ready and everything ready for Thanksgiving this Thursday, we have one last big training before Thanksgiving, which is going to be tomorrow. I am extremely excited that Derek Oy is going to be coming out to teach at the Downey Association of Realtors. Now, I'm going to note, I always appreciate learning from Derek. Derek is a very driver type personality. He's an amazing coach. He's got a huge heart. Right? He's got a huge heart. Derek's been interviewed by Gary Keller personally, right? That says a lot. There, Gary has, you know, agents that he interviews tend to be the agents that are in the top 100. Derek is one of those agents. His team, Movement Real Estate, is one of the expansion teams we have here in the office. They have hit immense numbers, right? 4.5 million in gross commission income, 411 units. Is a big business. What I love though about this team is often I look at some of these really big expansion teams that are doing hundreds of transactions, that are doing thousands of transactions, and a lot of them are in Texas or Arizona, right, or Florida or the Midwest or all these different markets. And so all of those different markets have different market conditions. What I love about Derek's team and Movement Real Estate is that they are a California-based expansion team with an arm in our office, right? So part of those units came from our office. Their base is at Chino Hills. They have multiple locations, but it's all California. And so he's going to be talking to us about listings, how to attract listings, how to price right in today's market to get them to move. This is going to be tomorrow at 1 p.m. And it is a great event to kind of jumpstart your Thanksgiving week. So I hope to see you all there. Trust me, you do not want to miss this training. It's going to be a great event. So I look forward to seeing you all there tomorrow at 1 p.m. Also, a reminder. So we reminded you at our meeting this past week, but I wanted to share it again. If you are planning on attending family reunion, right now is the time to start planning for it, right? Right now is the time to start planning for it, to get your tickets. This is going to be an amazing, amazing event. There are over 180 breakouts. What I love about family reunion is you essentially get the opportunity to customize your experience. So of course, there's going to be the main sessions, right? Where we're looking at what is happening with the market. So Gary's market update, interviews of top agents, et cetera. but all of the breakout sessions are unique to you and what you're looking for in your business. And every single one is going to be built out to what happens during a shifting market. So I highly, highly recommend you attend. Okay, let's jump into legislative updates. These are some of the legislative updates that I've gone over before. So I'm not going to go in too much on this. We're still kind of watching this. The most important one here that we've been kind of looking at, I would say, is going to be when we look at HR 9015, right? Or 9015. This is all about changing up capital gains exclusion on sales of primary residence. We're going to keep monitoring this one because this does have the possibility to bring more properties to market, right? Right now, one of the challenges that we're seeing, so I'll give you an example. I have a client right now that has a property that's priced at about 1.2. If that property sold at a million, right? If that property sold at a million, their capital gains taxes on that property is around 200K, right? Based on previous value. That is locking up that property because would you want to pay an extra 200K? They don't want to sell it, right? They're maybe not wanting to sell it because of that. Now, should HR 915 pass, right, as joint filers, now they have a capital gains exclusion on sale of primary residence that goes up to $1 million. And so it protects them so that they're getting actually more of that cash back versus losing it due to taxes. So this may create some opportunity to kind of free up some more inventory, which is why they are putting this on the market, right? So I'm not going to talk too much about these ones. We've kind of talked about these before. What I did want to talk about is Measure ULA, which is a new transfer tax that is being proposed. This is being called the mansion tax. And what it is essentially, right, essentially under this measure, real property that is valued at over 5 million, but less than 10 million would be subject to an additional tax of 4%. Properties at 10 million or more, right? Properties at 10 million or more would be subject to a tax of 5.5%. This new tax would apply to the entirety of the sale value, not just an amount like past those thresholds, right? And it's going to be regardless of whether the property is sold at a gain or a loss. The thresholds would be adjusted on the basis of inflation, right? This would be adjusted on the basis of inflation. If this tax does pass, it's going to apply to property sales on or after April 1st, 2023. The goal being what they're trying to do here is they're trying to create a tax that is going to go towards that essentially the revenue from this, right, that the revenue from this would go to help with affordable housing and tenant assistance programs. Now, as of this date, right, they've been counting the votes on this, right? They've been counting the votes and it was ahead on the latest vote count, but there has not been an update on whether this has passed or not yet. So the last update was literally November 14th on this bill as well, or this measure. We'll continue to monitor this, but I just wanted to share this because again, this is just another kind of measure that we hadn't talked about that went to vote as well. Okay. And then I did want to note this as well. This slide for you guys, I wanted to keep it here. I shared this article with you all last week. There are a lot of things in the news, right? There's a lot of things that are out in the news right now. And everything in the news is going to tell you, hey, we're going to experience decline. We're going to experience increase. There's so much kind of conflicting media that exists right now. Now, National Association of Realtors is predicting that home prices across the U.S. would not experience a major decline and could rise slightly in 2023 if mortgage rates remain at 7%. I'm going to note, with California specifically, because of some of the things I mentioned with the legislator, right, meaning that we have kind of this new legislative group that's coming in, we may see some price adjustments, especially as we see these kind of, you know, if the interest rate stays high, right, and we see this kind of supply number continue to go up, then we may continue to see some price adjustments. But as you guys just saw, as we went through four counties, right, that average active price, in some cases it was red, in some cases it's green, because every micro market is a little bit different, right? Every micro market is kind of dependent on its own supply and demand. And so when he's giving this kind of update, he's predicting at a national scale, but what he is predicting is not major decline, right? We may have decline, but we're not predicting major decline. What that means is that they're not saying, oh, we're going to have, you know, 10 million foreclosures like we saw in 2007, 2008, right? Maybe it's going to be more wrong. We may still have foreclosures, right? But 1 million versus 10 million is a really big difference. And so that's partially what he was talking about with this, why I want you to really look at the micro markets that you serve and look at those particular areas and what trends we're seeing in those areas, because it's going to be a little different, right, than it was. It's not the same as it was in 2007, 2008, you know, those markets. This market is similar because we're experiencing a market shift, but it's also different because the market that we experienced back then had a lot to do with mortgage regulation, right? With mortgages, too many mortgages that shouldn't have existed. That's not the case right now. Right now, what we're experiencing has a lot to do with inflation numbers, as well as some of the impact that we saw from the pandemic and appreciation going as high as it did. I do recommend Thanksgiving is a great time to watch The Big Short. If you haven't already, it's a great movie that kind of talks about what happened during the last market. So you have a little bit of an understanding what happened then. It's a great kind of enjoyable way to learn about what happened during the last market without it being kind of clear on, without it kind of skewing what is happening now and why right now is different, right? It's important to kind of have that understanding. Okay. I do want to know, I'm not going to go too much into this. I shared this last week. What I do want to share is that right now, I want to give you a couple tactics that you can utilize, right? That you can utilize this week to touch your database. If you have time to make phone calls, right? I want you to pick like your A leads, your hot leads, and your hot sphere of influence. So the sphere of influence that are kind of your VIPs, the ones that give you referrals, right? Those are great ones to call. Call and have a gratitude call, right? So not a call to seek business on this week, right? But a gratitude call. A call that says, hey, thank you so much for trusting me throughout your journey. I just wanted to give you a personal call and say thank you. Now, if they don't call, send a video thank you text message, a video thank you text message, right? So that they remember who you are. It could be something as simple as this. So this was a really nice kind of video. An agent does this. He actually fries the chicken for his Thanksgiving meal. And so what he does is as he's frying his turkey, he does a quick video and says, happy Thanksgiving to the client. I'm frying the turkey for our Thanksgiving meal. And as you can see right now, and he pans over to show the turkey in the fire. I was just thinking about people I'm most thankful for this year, and you immediately came to mind. I want to say thank you for the opportunity to help you and your family buy your home this year. I truly appreciate you. And I hope this is a Thanksgiving that you're surrounded by family, friends, and love. Have a great Thanksgiving and talk soon, right? So that's a thank you for a past client. Record a thank you for a past client, right? Record a thank you for the clients that are your VIPs right now. Record a thank you for anybody that sent you a referral this past year. This is a great touch. And you can do it in the kitchen, because here's the thing. People want to know that you're human, right? They don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. This is a great video opportunity. He sends to each person via text. And some people, he says he's had people send videos back showing their new grandbaby that they're holding for the first time, or saying thank you and sending a picture of the family because it's the family that's enjoying Thanksgiving in the home that they helped him purchase. This is a great Thanksgiving opportunity of gratitude to share with your clients while you're just doing the things that you're normally going to be doing for Thanksgiving. Okay. The next one was, some people like to deliver a Thanksgiving pie. I know some people do client events here. Obviously, this is a little bit more costly, so this might not be for you, or it might be something that you're only doing for your past clients with a handwritten note, right? Different opportunities here. Send a handwritten note, right? Dear client, as Thanksgiving approaches or during this Thanksgiving season, I made a list of people that I'm thankful for this year, and you immediately came to mind. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to assist you with the purchase of your home, or thank you for giving me the opportunity to help you on your homeownership journey, or thank you for that amazing referral you sent me and letting me help your friend so-and-so purchase their home. It was truly a pleasure working with you and developing our friendship through the process. I am truly thankful for you, and I hope this is your favorite Thanksgiving yet, right? This is a great way to show gratitude. I don't know about you guys. I tend to keep almost every thank you card that I ever receive. I have a stack of them because they make you feel good, right? So this is a great opportunity. Another one, if you're into donating to charities or getting involved with charities, right? Donating to a charity in their honor, or sharing that you're volunteering at a charity in their honor, right? For the work that they did this year, whatever that might be, right? Or a check-in call or voicemail, right? An example of what that check-in call or voicemail looks like. I hope you and your family are doing well. I was thinking this morning about the people I'm thankful for, and you immediately came to mind. I just wanna thank you for trusting me throughout the past year. I really appreciate your business and your friendship. I just wanted to call and say thanks, and I hope this is your favorite Thanksgiving yet. So you're noticing a theme here, right? Is this all about gratitude, right? All about that kind of gratitude piece. So I highly encourage you during this week of Thanksgiving, right? One, send the message, send the text message, right? Send the thank you card, whatever that might be, because gratitude is the highest form of energy. And Thanksgiving is an incredible, incredible time to be able to give of that gratitude and share it. And with that, my friends, I want to thank all of you for showing up, right? Especially during Thanksgiving week, for showing up every day for your business, for your clients. And thank you so much for all the work that you do to change people's lives, because that's what we do in this business. I wish you all an incredible Thanksgiving with all of your families, and I will see you tomorrow at the Downey Board of Realtors. Have an amazing one. Bye, everyone. Happy Thanksgiving.